Hey and welcome to my channel. If it's your first time here, my name is Emma Sandy and I'm a PhD student. I talk science on this channel, so if you're interested in that, feel free to stick around and subscribe. But today I'm going to tell you exactly what you need to know about flow cytometry and FACS. So today I'm going to give an insight into flow cytometry and FACS, what the difference is between the two, how the machines work, what the data means, and I will walk you step by step through analysing some of my flow data. So let's go! Flow cytometry is a way that biologists are able to analyse and count cells. It's super handy for immunologists to be able to study immune cells, but it can be used to study a lot of things, such as the cell cycle, maybe cancer cells, bacterial cells, or even microscopic parasites. So flow cytometers are the machines that do the work. They take a sample of cells that are in suspension, and this flows through the machine, hence the name. And everything in flow cytometry works by light and lasers. So through shining lasers on each individual cell and collecting the light that comes off of that, we can build up a picture of what each individual cell looks like. And if we collect, say, for 10,000 individual cells, we can have a good idea on what the population is doing. So we can get information on the size of the cell, the granularity, and we can add in dyes such as a DNA dye. We can also add fluorescent antibodies to be able to bind to, say, membrane proteins. And we can ask questions like, do all the cells in the population express this receptor protein? Does this percentage increase if we add a drug? So those are the kind of questions that we can answer with flow cytometry. In flow cytometry, these cells are analysed and we collect the data, but the cells themselves go into the waste and they're not collected. The only output is the data. The difference in FACS is we can analyse and then we can collect for these specific cells of interest. And people frequently confuse the two, so it's not technically FACS unless you are sorting for a cell population. So that's great, but if we're collecting data on every individual cell, what on earth do you do with it? So the first bit of analysis we do is to just look at the cells. So to first get a profile of each particle, we look into forward scatter FSC and side scatter SSC to understand how the light is scattering past that particle. So here is some of my data. So these are cells from a lung. So FSC is proportional to cell size and SSC is proportional to granularity. And this is what the data looks like. So it's one dot per cell. Now this data quickly gets overcrowded, so we add extra colours in to make this slightly more clear. Up here you can see the really granular and the large cells, and down here you can just see small pieces of debris. And somewhere in the middle we've got all the cell populations. So we're interested in the cells and not the debris, so we select them. And this is called gating. And we're only going to take these cells and then we're going to look for the next thing. So this excludes all the debris and only takes forward the cells that we're interested in. So after gating for cells, we want to do doublet discrimination, and this means that we're only going to be forwarding our analysis on single cells. And to do this, we change the y-axis to be forward scatter width, and this allows us to circle only the cells down here that are going to be single cells, and we exclude the doublets that are this population straying up to the top. And the next thing is that we want to look at only the living cells. So to do this, you can use lots of dyes, and the most common one is DAPI. So this stains the DNA of the cells, but it can only pass into the cells that are dead. So here we swap the y-axis for DAPI, and you can see there's a section of dead cells up the top that have taken in the DAPI dye, and there's a population of cells below that which haven't taken in the DAPI dye, so these ones are the living cells. So we select the living cells and we take them forward for the next analysis. So now we're ready to dissect exactly what is in this population. And for this, I've added two fluorescent antibodies. So on the y-axis we have EpCAM, and EpCAM is epithelial cell adhesion molecule. And on the x-axis we have CD45. So we can buy in antibodies with known targets and a range of different fluorescence molecules, so we can light up individual cells of interest. So in this example, I'm interested in epithelial cells. So I know that epithelial cells have EpCAM on them, so I've bought an antibody for anti-EpCAM with a fluorescence PE size 7 attached. And I also know that all these epithelial cells do not have CD45, which is a common leukocyte antigen, so we know that they're not immune cells, they're epithelial cells. So I'm able to pick these out from the population as having EpCAM on them, not having CD45 on them. So with this two-parameter plot, we can see cells that have neither down in the bottom left. We can also see some leukocytes, which are positive for CD45 over here. And we can also see the epithelial cells, which I'm interested in, which are EpCAM positive up here. And at this point, it's really good to go back and see what the cells that you've selected actually look like. So this is called backgating, where you take the cells of interest and you put it right back to the very first plot we made, which was forward scatter and side scatter. So we can see that most of these lung epithelial cells are big and granular. And obviously each flow experiment is completely different, using different antibodies, different gating strategies. But overall, the point of flow cytometry is to be able to analyse cells within a population. So now we'll talk you through understanding flow figures from real publications and introduce the types of figures that you're likely to see. So first we've got a contour plot. And here the authors were sorting for cells that are infected with a red fluorescent parasite. So on the y-axis we have red fluorescence, which the infected cells will be higher for. But remember that the uninfected cells will also have some background autofluorescence. So you can see in the red box between uninfected and infected that the gate is drawn on the uninfected cells. Then it can be copied over, and any cells which are inside on the infected graph, then these are the ones that are infected with the red parasites. So then these infected cells have been sorted, and you can see under microscopy that the red parasite is there. And this is another way to represent the same data. So this is by histogram this time. And here we can also see how the host cells are selected for. So similar to my data that we went through earlier, the authors are interested in epithelial cells. So first they've selected the EpCAM positive host cells, and then they looked by red fluorescence for host cells that are infected with red parasites. And here we can see the host cells in green and the parasites in red. And the contour plot before and the histograms here are two different ways to show the data. So this is another type of plot, a dot plot. And here the colours have changed slightly, but it's the same premise. So the parasites here fluoresce green, and compared with an uninfected sample, you can draw a gate around your infected cells. Now moving on to a pseudocolour plot. Panels like these are common in immunology papers. So this data is looking at macrophages, wild type or knockout for an immune modulatory receptor, which is cyclic E. You can see on the left that the cells are untreated. Then the cells are treated with LPS and this population shifts down. And that's showing that TLR4 is being internalized or endocytosed. Although the knockout cells do not show cyclic E expression, they're sitting here, they do still endocytose TLR4. So if you're ever looking at flow cytometry data that is making no sense, my first tip is to Google exactly what is on the axis, and hopefully it will be explained what they're trying to gate for. So I hope that talking you through some of my flow cytometry data has been useful, and that's it for this video, and I will see you next time for more science. See ya!